Good morning. It's sure a joy each week as I gather and see people sitting in pews and having conversations with each other and just fill the sacred space with that understanding that we can gather as a community. It's such a joy, and I hope we can continue. For those who are listening live stream, I hope that is you experience that as well in your homes as we gather for worship on this Sabbath day, when we celebrate the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. I have a few announcements, but first I'd like to have Shannon Bruins, who has been working as our president, through some conversations about worship. And so she has some things to say about that.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. It is nice to see all of you out there today. Appreciate that very much. I just wanted to say that many of you are aware of the Board of Music and Worship's concerns over the sustainability of the 5:30 worship service, which was discussed at Council earlier this month, July. It was noted in the minutes that were made available in the blue sheet last week. It's not only the board that has these concerns, however. Others have also wondered how much longer we should hold this service that has had low attendance since opening for in-person worship several months ago. Additionally, while Heather and board members continue to find people to be readers and to occasionally sing in the liturgical choir, there's really an ongoing need for help. Council has agreed, to reevaluate this worship service at the October meeting. This allows for a more adequate evaluation as school will be back in session and worship attendance typically returns to more normal numbers. We want to give every opportunity a chance to be met in order to reach a well-thought-out decision. Our hope is that we can continue to offer worship for those that do enjoy that 5:30 service. If you would like to be a reader, and that's for either 5:30 service or this, or sing in the liturgical choir, assist with communion, usher, those kinds of activities, please contact Heather Manis or call Marcy in the church office. There's also a sign-up sheet on the table back in the narthex. And I would also encourage you to attend a 5:30 worship service to be a part of that worship community. So thank you all very much.
Thank you, Shannon. I know my hope and prayer is we did not have our children participating in worship through the COVID. They were online. And my experience is when they have an opportunity to serve as acolytes or communion servers or readers at the 5:30 service, their parents come as well. And so that some families will find that to be the service of choice. And so we hope we continue to work that out and have opportunities for all to worship. I have just a couple of other announcements. First, we're preparing and giving thanks for the staff of Okoboji who will be coming here this evening, and then starting Monday through Thursday, we'll have summer day camp for our community. There's been lots of contacts and a lot of volunteers stepping up to the plate to make that all happen, and so we give thanks for that. They will be beginning from 9 to 2 o'clock every day here at the church, and there's a closing program for anyone who wants to attend Thursday evening at 5 o'clock. The other note is the Grace and Martha Circle has moved from their Friday time to Thursday at 9:30. So we will have the Ruth, Grace, and Martha Circles all meeting on Thursday at 9:30. Ruth Circle will be in the library, and the Grace and Martha Circle will be in the lounge. So that's news about that. We give thanks for the radio broadcast that was given in memory of Charles and Fern Johnson and in memory of Don Amet's birthday from Faye Amet and family. Thank you, Faye, for that support and the recognition of Don's birthday, which is August 2nd. A couple of other prayer announcements we'll be including in our prayers. The families of Mark Rollins and Donna Ling. I know the Ling family went back to Maryland and California, and so they're dispersing to their homes. And I believe there were friends of Mark from Las Vegas who were at the service. It was interesting to have both those services at the Salem Memorial at the same time. And so sometimes when we were at the Ling service, we would hear music from the Rollins family and vice versa. And so we continue to pray for their families as they mourn those losses. I decided also, we had a prayer petition last week for prayers for the continuing pandemic, especially for Riverside Bible Camp, who had to detain their camping for a week. I did find out from Okoboji that they have not had any issues there, and so I feel confident that we can have the summer program here. But there has just been a lot of, especially in the last week, confusing information and some misinformation, and so as we move forward, just prayers that we can, as a community, gather and do the best things we can to keep each other safe and healthy. So that is in our prayers as well. And also, the next five families in our continuing opportunities to pray for families of our church, you will notice that in your weekly announcements. And as you think about sharing the peace and you're not with us, take that chance to call or text or Facebook or visit with them and tell them that the God's peace is with them, and they are welcome to attend church, or we are wanting to meet their needs as we are able. I think those are all the announcements. Our gathering song will be on the monitors. And I have to move down to see, and I'm hearing some of you are having a hard time seeing as well. But we will sing "Hungry Falling on My Knees" as our gathering song. You may see it.
I'm falling on my
Sandra leads us in confession and forgiveness.
Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, one of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teaching and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen.
I invite you to stand.
Let us pray.
O God, eternal goodness, immeasurable love, you place your gifts before us. We eat and are satisfied. Fill us and this world in all its need with the life that comes only from you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Our first reading this morning comes from the book of Exodus, the 16th chapter, beginning with verse 2. The whole congregation of Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you. And each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.'" Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm today will be from Psalm 78. This psalm will be spoken responsively, beginning with the lectern. "So God commanded the clouds above and opened the doors of heaven.
Rain down.
So mortals ate the bread of angels. God provided for them food enough.
The Lord caused the east wind to blow in the heavens and powerfully let out the south wind,
raining down flesh upon them like dust and flying birds like the sand of the seas,
letting them fall in the midst of the camp and round about the dwellings.
So the people ate and were well filled, for God gave them what they craved." Our second reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with the first verse. "I therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, 'When he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive.' He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming, But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered them, Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. Then they said to him, What must we do to perform the works of God? Jesus answered them, This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. So they said to him, Well, what signs are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe in you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said to them, Very truly, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, Sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Beloved, grace and peace to you from our God who was and is to come, Jesus Christ, the true bread from heaven. Amen. When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. Now, you may already know my fascination with boats by now. How I received my first boat as a gift from my dad on my second birthday. And how I've told you before, in the early centuries after the resurrection, a boat was the symbol of the church. Now, it may have roots in the knowledge that the early disciples were fishermen. And the mast and the crossbeam on their boats from which the sail hung resembled a cross. So this image of a boat carrying people looking for Jesus, at least for me, makes some sense. Today, this image of a boat with a cross sailing across waters is the logo used to represent the World Council of Churches. An apt metaphor for people looking to cross over the divides, geographical, cultural, and doctrinal, that divide us, in the hope that one day all will be one. This idea, too, comes from the book of John, in the high priestly prayer, as he prepares the disciples for his leaving, and as they continue to look for signs, as John says, of Jesus, they will all be one. So think about this symbolism represented in the Gospel of John, perhaps written nearly a century after the resurrection. perhaps about 3 decades after the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, and 2 or 3 decades after the other 3 Gospels were written. During a time when followers of Jesus were being persecuted by the Romans or thrown out of their hometown synagogues, just like Jesus once had been. What does John's gospel have to contribute to the life of this troubled church? These people on a journey looking for Jesus in this next century. I think John is a master of symbols, using symbols like door, or the good shepherd, or the light, the way, the truth, and the life, the true vine, and today the true bread, to symbolize who Jesus is. And I just wonder, could he also be using the symbol of a boat to describe the early church? John writes, the crowds saw neither Jesus nor his disciples, so they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. How or where might those followers of Jesus have heard the words of hope and encouragement in the centuries after the resurrection? What might crossing over to the other side into uncharted territory look like, mean for them? Encountering the storms of life, the feelings of being vulnerable and afraid. And on the lighter side, maybe knowing that they just can't stay where they are. So they have to begin this journey looking for Jesus. So they gathered into boats. Like our Exodus story and so many other stories in Scripture, people began a journey. Abraham and Sarah, Ruth and Naomi, Jonah, who took a boat to flee from Jesus or from God, and the story of Moses and the Israelites, their long, arduous journey. There might have been at first a feeling of liberation and hope and adventure as they begin the journey, but then the journey becomes hard and it takes more faith. They might have some considerable amount of apprehension as they are in the midst of this journey. They will have to listen to God's word and trust his call to continue to be on the move and have faith. It's a move to a greater understanding of God's will for God's people. They won't always agree, and on occasion they will want to go back to the way things are. We heard that in our first reading for today. This crossing over for the disciples in this early community to look for Jesus, for it was a willingness to change and be drawn into this deeper relationship with God. And that means embracing a whole new kind of faith, a whole new way of living it out. There will be setbacks, roadblocks. It may take longer than had hoped, but like their ancestors before them, God will be with them. And they will, with God's mercy and faithfulness to God's promises, get through. And as they are looking for Jesus, Jesus will find them. Think of Paul, who I believe was shipwrecked 3 times in his journeys to share the faith with different communities all through Asia. See, when the crowds get to the other side, they found Jesus and asked him, "When did you come here?" It's the kind of question that has been asked of Jesus before in John's gospel. When the first disciples leave John the baptizer and begin to follow Jesus, they ask, "Well, where are you staying?" It can also be said, "Where are you abiding or dwelling?" It's like the question, "Well, where are you from?" When you're trying to get to know a person, where have you come from? I think those are some of the same questions being asked today when we think about Jesus. Where are you? Where'd you come from? Where do you dwell today? See, when Jesus says, come and see, we have an opportunity to follow. Andrew tells Simon they have found the Messiah, and Andrew and Simon, who were disciples of John the Baptist, now begin to follow Jesus. And Simon is now named Peter. And the next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee, and there he finds Philip. And Philip, too, begins to follow. And then Philip finds Nathanael, who at first is very unimpressed with this person named Jesus. Where did you come from? You are the carpenter's son from Nazareth, aren't you? What good could ever come out of that? It's then that Philip hears how Jesus saw him sitting under a fig tree, and that is the sign that convinces Philip that Jesus is the Messiah, the true teacher, the Son of God, the King of Israel. The question will then be, well, what kind of king will this Messiah be? Then we have the story of Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews, who wrestles with Jesus and what he does apart from the signs. Who are you apart from these signs, Nicodemus asks? And how are you connected to the God above? Jesus explains what it means to be born of water and spirit and ascending and descending from heaven. And Nicodemus has to wonder, how can these things be? And then in John chapter 4, Jesus meets a woman at the well in the heat of the day. And he asks her for a drink. And she wonders how a woman of Samaria, married five times and living with another man, whose ancestors worshiped not in Jerusalem but on another mountain, how would this Jesus ever enter into a conversation with her, let alone ask her for a drink? And yet in offering a drink, she is drawn into this deeper discussion about Jesus offering her living water, leading to eternal life, pointing to the day when true worshipers will not worship on this or that mountain, but worship the Father in spirit and truth. She's so impressed by this conversation and experience, she has to leave her water jars, run back to her neighborhood, and tell the folks in her community all that he had said and done. All these signs and wonders are making the people wonder, who is Jesus? Where does he come from? Does the work he does come from above? And I wonder if the hesitancy and lack of understanding about Jesus in the first century some ways mirrors some of the same questions we may now be having in the 21st century. In searching for Jesus, he invites us to come and see or come and follow. And sadly, we are sometimes unimpressed or wanting more. We are not living in a world where many who are hungry, thirsty, sick, marginalized, are looking for Jesus. But they are feeling left out and vulnerable, confused, and even beginning to wonder, who is this Jesus anyway? Where did he come from? Was he truly sent from above? And like Nicodemus, they and we all can be a bit confused and still be in the dark. But that's when we hear again those symbols that Jesus is the light. He is the bread. He is the door. He is the true vine. So what about the distractors and the controversies that surround Jesus? As Philip asks, can anything good come out of this? Now many are attracted because they have heard of the signs that he has done, like Nicodemus, turning water into wine, performing multiple healings, offering them food in abundance. But then how often do we just see those signs and they leave us wanting more? When the woman at the well hears of this living water Jesus offers, she asks him for this living water so that she will no longer be thirsty. And when Jesus talks about the true bread of God, which comes down and gives life to the world, they ask to have this bread always. Jesus tells them those who eat this bread will never be hungry, and those who believe will never thirst. But we are sometimes stuck on the signs and not what the signs point to. A living, loving presence of Christ today in the world, offering healing, hope, and blessings in abundance. Sometimes we just want more. Jesus is offering us this living water in our baptisms and his very own body in the meal we share. This is the body of Christ. This wine is the blood of Christ. Is it enough? Hearing God's word and promise, washed and fed, we participate in the mystery of Christ's very presence. What sign are you going to give us so that we may see it and believe in you? What work will you do for us so we can come to believe, they ask. Jesus said to those who believe, I am the bread of life. When you come to this font of living water, when you eat of this bread and drink of this wine, you will never be hungry. This is the food for your journey to strengthen you so you may continue to go out and look for Jesus, find him, and share that love with the world. Amen.
Lord of all, lift up the blessing.
Sandra, are you doing the...
Okay. Affirmation of faith. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father,
and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated for the prayer. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation.
You call your church to be the body of Christ. Awaken all the baptized to the gifts you provide for carrying out the work of ministry. Where the church is divided, knit us together and restore the unity of the faith. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You command the clouds above and cause the wind to blow in the heavens. Watch over deserts and wilderness places. Regenerate rainforests, defend species at risk of extinction, and grant favorable weather for fields and crops. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You summon leaders to respond to the needs of your people. Instill those who govern with patience when confronted with grievances and perseverance in seeking what promotes the well-being of the community. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You draw near to those who cry out for help. Feed those who are hungry, reassure those who are despairing, and accompany those who are in prison. Rain down the true bread from heaven that gives life to the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You receive all who come seeking a sign of grace. Make this congregation a place of hospitality for those accustomed to rejection. To those that felt excluded here or elsewhere, prepare us to welcome them in the name of Christ. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You provide food that endures for eternal life. Sustain us each day with the bread of life until we are gathered with all the saints and feast together at your heavenly banquet. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord, we pray for all those peoples and places that are still suffering from the pandemic, for doctors and nurses and hospital personnel who continue to care for the sick and dying, that the World Health Organization, the CDC, policymakers and politicians make ending this pandemic a common cause, that resources are distributed wisely and equitably. Hear us, O God. We continue to pray for the families of Mark Rowlands and Donna Link. We commend them to your eternal care and offer our prayers of comfort and support for the families as they mourn. Help us to provide for their needs as we are able. And may we know with them the blessed assurance of life everlasting. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray this week for these five families and members of Salem: Max Burgo, Timothy Burgo, Carolyn Bethke, Allison Bizanson, and Patricia Bitker. Keep them in your care and watch over them. May our families know the assurance of your abundant grace and mercy as we share the gifts you give to us. Increase in us the desire to be in fellowship with one another and witnesses to your love. Hear us, O God. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all. We share that peace. Thank you, guys. Yes, they are. Hey. And we prepare to receive our offering and communion.
Prayer. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." And again after supper, he took a cup and gave thanks and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as you remember me." We pray as our Lord taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come.
Thank you. be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray, amen.
I invite you to stand for the blessing. The blessings of God, who provides for us, feeds for us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Our sending hymn is on our monitors. It is called Forever.
To Lord, our God and King, His love endures forever. For He is good, He's above all things, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise.
With one hand and outstretched arm,
His love endures forever. For the love that's planned,
that's been reborn,
His love endures forever. sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. For God is faithful, for God is strong, for God is with us forever. Is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever. Rising anew, the setting sun, His love endures forever. Grace of God will carry on, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever.
Body of Christ.
Thanks be to God.